Well, let me begin by asking you a question. Okay, what do you think's the simplest program we could write?
Well, not being a programmer, but having done a lot of Computerphile videos, I suspect we're going for Hello World here.
So yeah, Hello World. I mean, it's probably the classic one everyone start with. If we can even write it on a piece of paper. I'm going to use C to talk about this. You could write it in any programming language of your choice. Let me guess, you walked into Dixon's and wrote a rather rude version of Hello World. I didn't, you probably did.
Oh, so the scrolling on the screen thing in BASIC is effectively
it's
Hello
basically
World.
Basically Hello World.
So print, I'd go sure, and print something and then, yeah.
That's the more advanced version, but yeah, it's a thing. So we could write it in C. We have our main function. We have to have a few arguments if we're doing this properly, because otherwise we'll get complaints in the comments. And then we can do a printf. Hello, dot, 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 backslash n, because we want to go onto a new line at the end, and include the right header files, and we've written Hello World.
These pens were bought because they're a bit quieter, and yet there's always a compromise somewhere, isn't there? There's never the perfect pen. Now we've got pens that you can't actually read.
So there's a Hello World program, and on the face of it, it is one of the simplest programs you can write. You can understand the instructions that's going on, and it says print whatever string it is, Hello World, and it prints it out. You compile it and you run it. But actually, when you think about what's going, is it, a lot of functionality is being hidden behind there. It's a good illustration. One of the things you see a lot in computer science is that we build computer systems by using layers of abstraction. So we're making use of a code library. So what we've already got here is a level of abstraction in that printf does a lot of things. It can do more than just print out a single line of text. We can actually get it to print out numbers, integers, as text, so we can read them on the screen, and it will convert them from the integer to things. So that's code library is hiding a whole layer of instructions. So we can think about this in terms of, we get another bit of paper, we'll turn it upside down and use the Australian version. We can think about it. We write our program, and we're writing it, and I've used the wrong pen again, we're writing it in C, and we're making use of that C standard library to actually make it do things. But of course, as we know, the computers don't understand C, they understand their machine code. So actually, we already have to convert this into the machine code for the program. So we convert it into the machine code for the CPU that we're running on. In this case, it's an x86 thing, but we could run it on a 68000, we could run it on a Z80, a 6502, PowerPC, whatever type of computer you wanted to. So we've already got two layers of abstraction there. We've abstracted away how the hardware works, because as soon as we write it in C, we can then compile it to run on different CPUs. But we've also started to abstract away how we actually print something out. So we can use printf to print a number, we can use it to print text, but we don't have to know how to convert a number into text.
What does the F stand for?
Okay, well, so that's a very good thing. Printf stands for print formatted, and it's what I was talking about. So you can say, I want to print this number, and you can also say, I want it formatted to look like this. So I want this many of leading zeros, I want this many decimal places afterwards, and so on. You can format the output, hence the F. So if we've got a program here, we've got our Hello World program, and we want to print out the variable with the 42 in it, we can say print out Hello World, and we can put a percent D in there, to say we want to print out a number, and then we can compile that program. Fortunately, I've not made any mistakes, and if we run that thing, it prints out the number 42. And again, this is a good example of that abstraction. If I were to print out that number with four leading zeros, I can say %04D, compile it again, and it prints out 0042. All that sort of complexity of, well, how do I print out that number? Okay, well, how do I print it out? We've got to divide it by 10. The remainder will be the digit I need to print last, and then the rest of the number, and then I do that again. That's all abstracted away from me as a programmer. I can think about what I want to write at a high level, which is I want to print out Hello World followed by the number with two leading zeros, and we can write that. So we've already abstracted that away. But that standard library then still needs to print that out. So it needs to take each of the characters it's generated and print them out on screen. or send them to the serial teletype that you're dealing with, or however it is you're outputting these things. Because if you think about it, a modern computer system, I'm sitting at my computer here, typing the commands in to run that program I've just written on this system, but I could have logged in remotely using SSH or something to another computer system and run the program there, and then it would have had to do something different. So in this case, it's printing it on my local screen. If I'd logged into a different machine, it would have to run the program there, send the characters it wants to print, having encrypted them, to my machine, and then print them out. So we've got a different thing. So even the C standard library is built to print things out, but it's built on an abstraction. In this case, that abstraction is the operating system. So we can add another layer of abstraction, which is the operating system. And most operating systems, certainly the modern ones we get, Unix, Windows, macOS, RISC-OS, whatever one you want to do, will provide some level of abstraction. So you can just say, print this, and it will then send it to the right thing and do the right thing based on what you're going. So our Hello World program has suddenly gone from being one line that prints things out, but that's then opened a can of worms because it's using a library. It's also being converted to machine code. We can see that, so we can tell the compiler to just produce the machine code for us. And then if we open that up, we get the machine code version here. And as you can see, that's quite a lot more lines of text that we've got there. We can see there the call to printf, and we're doing various things to get that. How that works is perhaps another video on how we call a function in a machine code. So let's backtrack a bit from printf, because as we've talked about, that's a more complicated implementation. It can format the text. And let's just think about how we can just print a single string to the screen. So let's rewrite this program to use puts, which is another C standard library function that can print out a thing. This one can't do formatted text, so we remove our additions. And so we now got a slightly simpler version of Hello World that still does the same thing, in that it prints out Hello World. It also prints an extra new line because puts, when it outputs as a standard output, adds a new line to you. So it's got a slightly different bit of functionality. But we can start to think about how that works. So what that is given as input is the string Hello World, which is arranged in memory. Suddenly our program is getting more complicated because we're actually having to think about how things are stored in there, as basically a series of memory locations, one after the other, with the H followed by the E, followed by the L, followed by another L, followed by an O, and so on. And so what putstring would have to do, or a naive implementation of it would do, is it points at the H, it gets that character, prints it out to the screen, then it gets the next character, prints it out to the screen, then it gets the next character, prints it out to the screen, and so on, until it gets to some end marker, which in C is done by putting a zero character, the ASCII code zero, to represent the end of the string. Other programming languages do it differently. Pascal, for example, put the length of the string at the beginning as a number, so it said there'd be X characters, and then it print out X characters. C says the string's ended by putting a zero at the end. So we've already, what looked like a simple program, when we take away the layer of abstraction, becomes more complicated. Now, actually, if you were to implement this, you wouldn't print each character separately, because to print it, we've said we have to call the operating system, and every time we call the operating system, we have to pass control from the user mode to supervisor mode, the operating system's mode, which takes some time. So actually what we would do is send it directly as a string to the operating system, and then the operating system will print out that whole string for us. So we can change our program to do that, in that we now use the command write. Write can send it to lots of different places. So we can send it to the standard output, which on Unix is number one. Send the string, and now we need to tell it how many characters there are. So hello's got 5, world's got 5, that's 10. We've got a space and a new line. That's 12, so we want to send 12 characters. So let's compile that version up. And I haven't put the right header in for that, so we're getting an error message. So let's include the right headers. It still worked. And now if we run Hello World, it still prints Hello World, but we've taken away another layer of abstraction, in that this case, my C program is directly calling the operating system. So we've removed that level of abstraction. Now, as we said, the operating system code then has to interact with all the different things. And on a system like Unix, because of the heritage of it back to the 1970s and earlier, it emulates a teletype machine. And a teletype machine was basically a typewriter that was controlled by electronics, and you sent the characters and it moved things one after the other, printing the characters out onto paper, not unlike this. And then when you sent the line feed character, you actually moved to the next line. Actually, the original teletypes required you to send both a carriage return and a line feed, because you had to send the thing back to the beginning of the carriage.
So these are mechanical bits of
equipment. These are mechanical bits of things. And actually, you still see this today. The reason why Unix and Windows differ on how text files are encoded is that Windows encodes both the carriage return, which sends things back to the end, and the line feed to go on to the next line that you had to send to the teletype, whereas the Unix said, well, actually, we're always going to send that. Different things have different things. We'll just send a line feed. And so the Unix operating system abstracted that away. So our Hello World program looks simple and is simple because there's a whole load of other things going on which are hidden from us. They're abstracted away. So we can think about it in terms of, I want to print out this line of text. But actually, under the hood, there's lots of things going on, extra bits of code which are doing things. Even things like when it appears on screen, the operating system is having to think, well, actually, I've got to draw the dots that make up the H here. And because the way a teletype, certainly in the Western world, has been designed to work, means that the E is following that, then I've got to print the E after that and work out what positions they're going on. And so if you were to look at all the code necessary to write Hello World from the bare hardware, bearing in mind that you've got to find out what hardware you've got on there and then talk to it in the right place, you'd find it to be a lot of code to do a very simple program like Hello World.
Is there a simpler program?
It's a program that doesn't do anything.
What, the open start program?
Well, if I just delete that, we've then got a program that starts and stops and doesn't do anything.
Would that still call operating systems and open libraries and things?
So this is an interesting thing. So yeah, this is a good point, is that actually that program, if we compile it and have a look at the machine code, we now see that actually there isn't much there. This is basically the whole code here. The rest of it's just setting up various things so it works.
Would the compiler have done things there then? And
yeah, so we've got about four or five instructions, but that isn't the beginning of our program. When you compile a C program, there's an extra bit that's joined onto the beginning, that's linked onto the beginning, which sets up the operating system, which says how much memory this program needs and so on, and gets things to the point where that program could work. So actually that isn't the whole program, but it's getting close enough. And of course, we still have to bear in mind that we've got to boot the computer up. When we turn the computer on, the computer starts in a defined way. It starts executing code at a defined location. Your BIOS is then there in a modern machine, or your UEFI in a really modern machine, executing things, and that will then start to the point where it can load the operating system. The operating system's loading up so it can talk to various other things and so on. And there's all these layers hidden behind us to the point where we can just literally type, run this program. Layers of abstraction are great in computer science because it means that we can think about the program we want to write, Hello World, rather than having to think about all the nitty-gritty details that we actually need to get that implemented.
Now, the problem is, if I send this off to the website, I've just given them my password. I mean, not quite, because SHA-1, it's a hash, but that can be broken, especially if my password is not good, right? And also, he's got a bunch of these passwords and hashes already computed in this database. So as soon as he sees that I've got the hash,